Kia ora mai tātou i tēnei ahiahi. Ngā mihi ki a koutou i tēnei wā. Kuni ka timata au i te karakia. Kia timata mai tēnei wānanga. E pāna ki tēnei kaupapa mo tēnei wā. Ko te mea tuatahi, ka inoe tātou i tēnei wā, he manaakitia mai ki tēnei kaupapa. E te atu i tēnei wā, kia timata mai mātou i tēnei wānanga, he manaaki mai ki a mātou. Kia pai ai tā mātou kaupapa, kia pai ai tā mātou wānanga i tēnei wā, kia whakamahana mai tēnei reo hoki i te motu mō ngā wā ki tonu atu, ake ake, āmene.
Amen.
Kia ora, everybody. Lovely to see everyone here this afternoon. A big welcome. Before we begin our kōrero, our kaupapa kōrero with Kyle Mika, Professor Mika. First thing is just to welcome everyone on board and thank you for coming to our first series of our Kaupapa Rangahau series, where we're going to begin the series from the first, which is today, till November the 24th. We have our team from Te Manawa Haukura here as well. You'll see them around the screen. I won't go to each individual because we've got quite a tight time frame for this afternoon session, but they'll wave to you. So I'll just tell the team to wave from Te Manawa Haukura. Yay, kia ora koutou. Ngā mihi kia koutou katoa from our hearts to yours. But also a big shout out to our director, Becky Kittle or Rebecca Kittle, Dr. Rebecca Kittle, she's on screen as well. So I just thought I, as our first director of Te Manawa Haukura, to acknowledge her mahi as well. So to come and start our new this new session, I just wanted to say a big thank you to Kyle for coming this afternoon, for spending your time with us. He's a professor at the School of Indigenous of Māori and Indigenous Studies at Aotahi, which is a school of Māori, School of Māori Indigenous Studies at Canterbury, and he's done quite a bit of work around Māori philosophy, and in terms of our colonised realities. We brought him in today to have a kōrero, but more so around telling his story. Oh, who can't hear?
Lucky.
Sorry, Lucky, can you hear me? Can you? Oh, sorry, I'm just stopping. Just checking to see if everyone can hear. Can you hear me at all? Thumbs up? Yep. Just Lucky. Kia ora, Lucky. You might have to just check your okay. So just before I'll just continue on. Sorry for that break. Where was I? Oh, Kyle Mika. We've brought him in today. And so the series is really around just firstly to acknowledge the mahi that you're doing, Kyle. I'll let you introduce yourself. But finding out, what was it that he was passionate, well, his kaupapa that he's going to talk to us about today, why is he passionate about it and why is it so close to his heart? And the kind of things of like, what legacy does he want to leave for the next generation? So we've brought the session into around finding more about you, Kyle, and to just freely have an internet active session with you as well, and to make it pretty much formal in terms of Q&A. If you've got questions, everyone, you can just drop it into the chat. We'll take a list, and at the end of the session, we can have a kōrero with each other. We'll start, and the session finishes at 1 o'clock this afternoon. So I'll leave this to you now, Kyle, and allow you to carry on. Thank you for coming, and thank you to everybody. So, ngā mihi kia tātou katoa. Kia ora.
Kia ora rā. Tēnei te mea atu ki a koutou i runga anō i te karangatanga o te wā. He mihi tēnei ki a koutou, kua mihi mai nei. Tēnā rā koutou katoa. My name is Kyle Mika, and I'm from Tūhorangi Ngāti Whanaunga, and I'm head of school down here in Canterbury. I moved here 2 years ago from the University of Waikato, and it's a real pleasure to be able to come along and be able to talk to you about some of the Māori philosophy context and some of my experiences with that. I would say, when I'm presenting, if you've got any questions and I notice them on the side, I'll answer them. But otherwise, if I don't, it's not for want of desire. It's more because I haven't seen them and I'm busy kind of presenting. I don't actually have a PowerPoint today, and that's I mean, I sort of don't apologize for that because I quite like not presenting with PowerPoints. I think they can become a bit didactic after a while and too directed.
Carl,
Yeah.
sorry. We're just trying to get the captions going for someone who needs them for you.
Okay.
So sorry, can we just tie for a second?
I'll put it.
Sorry, can you try talking again?
Becky, I like your husky voice.
Thank you. Have been to sing. It's still not working, is it?
No.
Okay. Do you want to just carry on, Carl, and we'll try and work it out as we go. Yeah, sorry about
Cool.
that. Cool.
Clearly, Māori philosophy is one of those like really big things that covers a broad spectrum. And I'm going to talk a little bit about where I fit within that and my contribution within that. A bit of background into falling into philosophy. I actually have never been trained. I've never done one single paper in philosophy. So in many respects, I fell into it, but I've always been someone who's desired to find out more about the nature of things. It's kind of been part of my own nature. And so that's always been really in the background. And I wasn't really happy in my academic life until I started to look more deeply at into philosophy. And I had been based in kaupapa Māori work back in the late 90s. And I was really grateful for that experience. But I, in hindsight now, I think I found it too much about human beings and too much about the social world. And that's not surprising given that kaupapa Māori has been strongly influenced by the Frankfurt School. But also some of the other experiences I had was that I used to be a lawyer in the dim, dark past. And I remember coming back from a Waitangi Tribunal hearing and being really disillusioned with the way in which inquiry was happening. So even though it was happening in Te Reo Māori, these same rules of inquiry were taking place. And I won't go into too much about that at the moment. That's kind of a full lecture. But what it highlighted for me was that there was a gut problem for me that existed at the very basic, in the very basic foundations of the process of the Waitangi Tribunal. And I also noticed that in the criminal court as well. And I came back from one hearing at the Waitangi Tribunal and I sat down and for some reason, and you people will know how random these things can be in terms of tohu, but I Googled Heidegger. Martin Heidegger is a German philosopher. And I have no idea why I Googled him to this day, but he introduced a concept of being to my thinking. And I had already been thinking in terms of being, but without articulating that as such. But he provided me with the term. And I mean, it's one of those moments that you can look back at and say, oh, there's an origin there to the way I thought. It's not the origin, but it's a contributing factor to it. And I often had found in the late 90s, or even before then, mid to late 90s, even well before then, actually, I was having philosophical discussions, but it was more in the area of political philosophy. And it wasn't too much later that I discovered that actually where I wanted to be was in the area of what's called metaphysics, or very first principles. As Vine Deloria, the Native American philosopher, defines them. And so much of what I'm going to talk about today is really my work within first principles. And perhaps part of that is kind of what is Māori philosophy? How can we talk about Māori philosophy? What is Māori philosophy? There are many kinds of Māori philosophy, as I was saying before. One of the things that comes to mind is that Māori philosophy, as far as I approach it, is that it's highly speculative. So it's never saying this is the complete answer here. What it's doing, what I've always been clear in my work, is saying this is a possible explanation. Let's work with this. We need lots of possible explanations. And those are really important things to keep in mind, is that for me, philosophy, unlike perhaps something like science or something like that, doesn't pretend to have the final say. It doesn't pretend to wrap up the state of affairs and say this is what it is. So philosophy for me has always been really productive in that regard. It's always been something which I've built on constantly because it's allowed that openness. One of the words that comes to mind for me with philosophy is the term whakaaro. Whakaaro, I'm sure I don't have to spell that for you, but for those who are not aware of the term, that is one that is often used as a substitute for the term philosophy. You notice there that sometimes people will call it whai whakaaro. I've always been happy with just the term whakaaro. And I've done a fair bit of writing on what that might be like, and other people have too. The interesting thing about whakaaro, if we think of it as philosophy or just as thought, is that it's ancestral. And to that extent, whakaaro on some whakapapa is an actual ancestor. Now, I don't know what, I haven't yet still sat down and thought solidly about what that means for thought. But what I suspect it means is that thought is matter. Thought is material. It's not just simply how we've been colonized to think of thought, if we ever do think of it at all, how we assume thought is in our normal way of being, which is that it's something that you operate through in order to make sense of the world, and it's a human faculty. In fact, I think whakaaro probably for us is something which is beyond the human. And so when we go to philosophize, when we go to think, we are actually operating with the more than human, and we have to keep that at the forefront of what we're doing. That's always been my position on it. I've always been aware that I think, that's fine, that's all very well, but actually there's something else that directs me to think and allows me to do that to begin with. And I would probably suggest that anything we do is like that from a Māori worldview. It's not entirely human directed. For those of you who are interested in where that comes from, that it is entirely human directed, I mean, I'm not going to go into that today, but you could look at people like Descartes and let me just put that name in there in the chat. Some of the usual suspects that I call them, that if you're interested in the genealogy of philosophical colonization, you might want to look at those people. But they stand in stark contrast to where we operate in terms of philosophy. And in terms of whakaaro, absolutely, completely, starkly different. One of the other things about whakaaro, it is, for me, and I think other people have said this as well, is that philosophy is related to the gut. Mm. It's related to your first impression about something. Now, in Western thought, you don't pay homage to that source. You know this yourselves undoubtedly through your research, is that you're encouraged to focus on an unemotional sphere and develop that and develop clarity, and that's the main thing of your argument. I mean, I think that can exist in Māori philosophy or in my Māori philosophy, but what comes first is that gut response to state of affairs or to an idea or to something that exists that comes into your regard, which is partly the very definition of whakaaro. Aro is like a regard. it's like a regard that comes in front of, and Charles Royal talks about that. So because of that, Whakaaro really operates with the emotion. It's not to say that you can't have the intellect operating at exactly the same time, but I tend to think that it's, first of all, that gut reaction to something. And for me in the past, it's tended to be one of those things that's operated in terms of something that I disagree with. And one of the big things that I've disagreed with is that we have to think along the lines of Western logic. And I will come back to that later. But for the time being, let's just sit with the idea that Whakaaro is, and therefore Māori philosophy, is based on this kind of gut response to things, the emotions. And it's not surprising then that Takirirangi Smith talks about it in relation to Te Whānau Ārangi, which is, you know, the sky father, if you want to think of Rangi that way, but more immediately in terms of emotion. So the Rangi makes up a lot of the words to do with emotion. But it's not all solemn. I mean, this is one of the things that I would be really clear for myself as someone who works in the area of Māori philosophy, is that it's not all kind of, it's not all stoic. You know, it's also actually being able to laugh and see the absurd in a situation. And thankfully I have the ability to inappropriately do that sometimes, and to see the weird tensions that exist and the awkwardness that exists in a situation or something that I've seen. And that will spark for me an idea, and it will allow me to, and I will then be able to explore that idea. There are some other things about Whakaaro that I could talk about, but if I move more towards the kind of philosophy that I'd mentioned the first principles thing. Now, in Māori philosophy, there are a couple of us who are doing Māori philosophy, and they won't necessarily talk about what I'm talking about. Some of them will be more in the epistemology, the science and mātauranga area. Others will be more talking about it with a heavier emphasis on tradition, for instance. Others, such as myself, are more in the area of first principles, which is metaphysics. And what that really means is my work has tended to focus on what are the very foundational claims to existence. And the very foundational claim that I see repeated again and again by Māori scholars is that the world is interconnected. Now, there's a corollary to that, which is that the world is one, which is the kind of interconnection that I've tended to talk from. So as far as I can tell, there may be coexistent modes of existence. The two that I'm talking about are that the world is interconnected, where you've got these things in the world that are connected by Māori. And that's a common way of talking about interconnection in the Māori academic world. Or there's one which seems to be very different to that, which is everything is completely one. There never is any separation between things in the world at all. And maybe I am the river and the river is me as part of that, as an example of that. There is absolutely no division between one entity and another, one thing and another. Now, it's possible that there are both those two things at work, that at the same time as there is complete oneness, that there is also at the very same time things being interconnected as nodes on a kind of a field of energy or something. But this is the kind of discussion that I have with myself and with my ideas and with my students about interconnection. And the reason I raise this is not only because it's my experience that I work in, it's also one of the most oft-cited or frequently repeated Māori tenets, philosophical tenets. if I pick up probably 90% of Māori articles or chapters, they will mention that the world is interconnected. Now, you probably have seen that yourselves. It's often, if you step back and think about it, you'll see it again and again. It's a theoretical premise that is repeated again and again. And I think one of the reasons that we repeat it is because it's a counter to the way colonization has set things up in the world, which is the opposite to that. And that is that things in the world are immediately fragmented, they're divisible, and you gain clarity about the thing that you want to. And that thing exists in isolation, therefore, because you have deemed it to do that, to be separable from everything else because of your mind. Now, a problem I have with our scholarship around this area is that very, very few people are stopping with that idea and sustaining it. It's like it's mentioned and then moved on. And the problem with that is that if you do that, you don't address it and you don't give it full bandwidth. And the problem with that is that you might revert in your own writing back to the idea that things in the world are separable. Quite apart from the individual existential component of this, there's also just basically, I think, a lack of scholarship in the area. This is not a criticism of anyone. This is just the reality of our research, I think, that we have outcomes to provide. And in trying to provide outcomes, it's these dwelling within the theoretical areas, within the metaphysical realms, is not understood to be particularly a research output. Right, it's not going to get you funding, let's put it that way. I mean, it may do in a parallel universe, but it may do in a Marsden. But in and of itself, it's not something that occurs to people to explore because it's not social, it's not concrete, it's not out there in the world. Actually, it sits behind every aspect of colonization. What else do I want to talk about here? Stating that things in the world are one, that the world is completely collapsed, is possibly the most radical counter to the idea that things in the world are separable. And as I say, all institutions and all aspects of our colonized experience can be sourced in the idea that all things in the world are separate from each other. And if you want to talk about it in Māori discourse, they don't have whakapapa with each other, or they're not whanaunga to each other. And I mean, I've argued that we see this happening in the one of the arguments against science and Mātauranga being the same is that science isn't premised on the idea that things in the world are automatically one. Okay. So just to reiterate what I was talking about with, I'm just looking at the chats here, maybe we can come back to that soon. But I go about doing Māori philosophy through language primarily, but I want it to be clear that I personally don't think that the issue starts with language, that any philosophical issue starts with language. It actually starts with worldview, and then it's expressed through language. And so language is one very interesting and important way to access a discussion about worldview. It depends on what your philosophy of language is, and I don't have time to talk about philosophy of language today so much, but when you have a philosophy of language which says that there's something inherent to the language that is inseparable from the language, then you might be able to argue that language is the start of a philosophical issue. But it's been my experience that in the West, people have tended to think of language as being separate from the object. And, you know, you go and you get some idea about the object through language and you're able to talk about it. I can talk to you about something because we have a shared understanding of the word around that. But I do know for a fact that people and here I am starting to talk about philosophy of language, by the way, when I said I wouldn't, but that my understanding is that we understand language as a sort of a spiritual phenomenon. And with that in mind, and probably any language, not just Māori language, but any language, language itself, reo itself, is possibly a spiritual phenomenon for us. With that in mind, we would want to think of language as operating with its objects differently than how we commonly use language, if we ever think about that. So language is one way that I do that. What I'll do is I'll take a term, a Māori term, or an English term occasionally, but more often these days a Māori term. And then I'll go, look at how it's translated. That's rubbish. And that's my gut response there. And I'll acknowledge the gut response. The gut response is my tūpuna, if you like. And my tūpuna stays with me as I develop an argument around that. Some of the terms that I've been using recently in developing my ideas is wā, which is nowness. For me, it represents a complete nowness. It's the idea that everything is one, but with a complete resonance. It's so completely now that there's an intensity or a persistence to the world. And at certain points in time, we have an understanding of something because the world shows to us in that intensity, in that intense nowness, something for us to consider. And that's where you have something like wānanga. You have a state of affairs that is so completely now that you there is a kind of learning and teaching involved because the thing has showed itself to you, or the world has shown itself to you through an object or through an idea. But it's not just teaching and learning. So that would be another bugbear of mine, is that wānanga is just learning. It simply doesn't capture the full essence of it. I've noticed actually that translations, when they're used in relation to the Māori language, they intersect. They're not the Māori word, but they are a reduced version by far of the Māori term. So it's like our ideas glance off the English equivalent, but then they go into the ether and spread around, and there's a kind of an aura around the term which is important to acknowledge, not just the English translation. So wā is one example of that. It's often, as you know, translated as time and space. I suspect we didn't have a notion of time as such. That's a very Western thing. I suspect we had different nownesses, or different intensities of the now, but I don't think we had time. I think that's a really bad translation. And sometimes with these translations, as you know, and you'll see this in policy, there's an insidiousness, because the English term or the Māori term acts like a Trojan horse for the English, for the Western worldview to come in. And this is where philosophy, I think, is quite useful, even at a pragmatic level, for saying, hey, hold up, back up, stop assuming that our terms are equivalent. You may say they're not, but we don't see that demonstrated in, for instance, policy or law and health and so on, education. Another term is why, which is separated out who and water. I think we had an ontological category there which tied them together such that they were completely one, a bit like whenua, actually, with its apparently separate meanings. Āhua is another term I'm working on at the moment in relation to aesthetics. The other thing that I think is important for us to be looking at is logic. What are the basic concepts by which we make sense of the world? And how can we convey them so that they make sense to others? And this came up as an issue for me recently in the science and mātauranga debate, again, if I refer to that again, because I've done a bit of work in that. And what I noticed with, if I'm to be perfectly blunt, with a lot of our assessments, and I mean, I do this all the time as well, I don't think that there's, at the moment, any way of escaping this, is saying, we have that there. So mātauranga Māori is science because of these attributes. But those attributes aren't necessarily the ones that we would have privileged in the past. So simply because science, simply because mātauranga Māori is empirical or uses observation, I don't think that that is sufficient criteria for us to be judging equivalence by. And this is where I go back to my work in metaphysics, is that if things in the world are interconnected, then in order for science to be mātauranga Māori, we'd want to say, does science acknowledge that all things are collapsed into one, or all things are one? Does science do that? Does science encourage an idea that the person, the scientist, and the object are whanaunga? Those are the kinds of criteria I think we should be operating by in many of our decisions about these kinds of arguments. Tikanga and law is another one that's recently come up. You know, tikanga is law. Do we really want to, to incorporate the world that comes with law into our own language? Does tikanga, does law do the same thing? Does it operate as if things in the world are one? No, it doesn't, perhaps. So, I mean, those are some of the logics that I'm talking about here. And I think, I mean, there's something in me that rebels against this idea, but we don't realise it, but our rules of logic that we've been operating by through colonisation are quite subconscious. The fact that I'm sitting here talking to you and perhaps making sense because of my structures of argument are based on an unstated logic. They're not incidental. And it's a logic that's not of our own. So what I'm saying is that at some point we probably need to create our own systems of logic, which possibly have nothing to do with the understandability that we operate by today. Now, I mean, before we go to arguments like is science mātauranga, or is law tikanga, or is knowledge mātauranga, or is philosophy whakaaro, whatever, we probably need to develop our own rules of our own criteria before we do that. Otherwise, we're just drawing on those problems to assess the problem. Okay. So that gives you some idea of the work that I've, the idea that, that the sort of, sorry, the field that I've been working in. A lot of the work that I understand, because there's a few of us around doing work in the philosophy area, it's quite individualistic. And you can perhaps understand why, you can perhaps appreciate why, and that's an interesting thing. I think, you know, in universities, I still get plenty of time. I'm head of school now, so not so much, but I've never been really pressured to play well with others. By that I mean to be forced to collaborate or anything like that. Māori philosophy and philosophers, I think we tend to go inwards, and that's our own personal space. If there is a community, it's a community of ideas. But this is not to say that we don't talk with people. We do. I mean, I'm stereotyping here. And I mean, the other Māori philosophers that I'm thinking of anyway, and there'll be Māori philosophers among you, but the ones that I'm thinking of aren't here to say, no, you're wrong, Carl. So my experience of Māori philosophers is this. We tend to go inwards. We talk one-on-one with people, or we give talks, but our main development of ideas is within ourselves, and it often happens through writing. I know, I mean, this is probably me talking here, but I often have a vague feeling that there is a philosophical thing at work, but I won't be able to fully pad it out until I commit pen to paper. That's just the way I think some of us operate. Quite often, more often than not, with some notable exceptions, but more often than not, philosophy happens without data collection. So we're not often going out into the field and collecting data, or interviewing people maybe I'm just thinking of myself here, but there's a couple of others I know for sure I can say are like this as well, that we have that idea we want to explore and we go, wow, that's what I need to do. And we just sit down and we write and bring the ideas together. So whether that's research or not, I don't know. And this is I haven't really delved into this that much, but I don't really care too much what it's called. People can call it research if they want to, or they can call it scholarship. That's where I've heard some people put it more in the realm of, in that area. It's more scholarship than research because it's got nothing to do with empirical data. In a way, if you look at Charles Royle's, there's a quote by Charles Royle where he talks about, I think it's mātauranga I ho maingia e te ao, or something like that. There's a quote that I've got. There is a kind of empirical data in philosophy. There's like tohu that you kind of see and you feel and you go and explore that. It's just not data in terms of deliberately going out and finding it. Okay, I'm just having a look to see if I've got a few notes here. Yeah, there's some really exciting work, and I see a lot of the really exciting work going on with PhD students. So here at Canterbury and Aotearoa, we have several students who are doing philosophical theses, conceptual ones, and they range from a theory of aesthetics, Māori theory of aesthetics, a Māori philosophy or Māori notion of fragmentation, Māori notion of resonance through the term rangi. I mean, there's quite a few of them who are doing really, from my perspective anyway, really interesting work, and I'm really grateful to those students for being able to take up where we meet our limits naturally. We can only cover off so much individually, and it's an area we see as being really important, but quite a quiet area in the sense that it doesn't, Whakaaro doesn't have the sequins and the glamour of its louder cousin, Mātauranga, should we put it that way. But it is sitting silently in the background there, kind of developing itself, and it's almost the Cinderella. It's the Cinderella of things. I've had enough of analogies. I won't go there anymore. But you know what I mean. It doesn't really have the. It has a certain kind of heft, and I think there's people who are understanding that and finding that really interesting and wanting to develop a topic within Māori philosophy that they're really passionate about and that they can go forward with, and that's going to add to the field. Okay, so I think that probably I've been almost obscenely rushing over everything that I think I need to as an introduction to the work I do. There's lots more in it, but I'm really, really grateful for the opportunity to, you know, to be able to come here and talk to you all. You've been a very quiet audience, except in the chats. So I look forward to some questions there, and
Just before Dina, sorry, I was just being the captions person. So I was trying to type what you were saying. So that's why there was all that activity in the chat.
Is that why? I did see your name pop up quite a bit, Becky.
Yeah, so. You were like, what the hell is she talking about?
Yeah.
That's why. So I don't know if I've caught everything that you said, but hopefully for those that need it, there's the sort of key points, and we'll also can provide the transcript. But just while I have the mic, can I ask a question?
Sure.
Firstly, thank you. It's always really stimulating hearing you, kōrero, and it really kind of opens the mind, things that one doesn't even think about, actually. As you kind of point out rightly, many of us put in our chapters things like the Māori world is all interconnected, and you know, and without much more, a kind of sort of an assumption that that's enough and we don't interrogate it any further. One of the things we've talked a lot about at the Wānanga is just thinking about this language issue, is the sort of difference between rangahau and research, and whether so the Wānanga has taken a stance around using the word rangahau, but we're also kind of working in this sort of funding system that uses the word research and then translates research kind of pretty bluntly as rangahau. Did you have any kind of thoughts on that?
I do indeed.
You do indeed. Very good.
If I haven't started, I have a little quote. I have a little quote here, but I want to put into chat. Okay. And that your message is too long. Okay, I'll read it out. Now many of you are familiar with this. This is a quote from the Maramatanga. I think it might have been Charles Royle, but it's from the Ngā Pau, sort of Maramatanga, one of the Te Pū Wānanga issues. Okay. Rangahau. In our traditional literature, rangahau does not mean research, but rather to seek, to quest. The most well-known use of the term is in this Maioha for the Dead. Kimihia rangahaua, kaihia koutou ka ngaro nei, tēnā kariro ki pairau ki te hui huinga o te kahurangi, e oti atu, seek, where are you that are missing? You have gone beyond pairau to the gathering of the treasured ones. Here rangahau is used to mean seeking. Peite Hurinui Jones deepens our understanding of the term in his explanation in King Portito. Rangahau appears in Pei's presentation of the Tainui creation story, a portion of which speaks of the creation of Tiki Ahua and Tiki Apua. These characters were fashioned from uku pākeho or limestone and stand as the first likeness of man, as Pei puts it. When Tiki Ahua was completed, a heart was given unto it, and the heart was called rangahau, the questing breath of life. When the heart was implanted, it was purified by you with these words, this is rangahau. And so then it goes on to talk about how it's to do with questing. But I think one of the important things with that quote is there's a very, very strong influence from the divine and the non-human, the more than human. Now, I don't know what you're going to make of that in research, but it's not research. The term does not disclose a world which equates with rangahau there. And in fact, the term research is a human thing. It really emphasizes, if you break down research into its etymology, it's to search, and re means to intensely search. So it's like the human being is intensely, the human project is to intensely search. That is the basis of research. Whereas rangahau allows you to go out and do kind of inquiry, but at the backdrop is this idea that you are only able to do that because the non-human affords you that opportunity or constitutes you.
Right.
So I think somehow rangahau or research, rangahau anyway, rangahau, if we allow that that's a different thing to research, if you do rangahau, there has to be a constant, for me, there has to be a constant destabilization of the idea that the human is central throughout it. Now, in many respects, good luck with that. Yeah, so carry on. Yeah.
Oh, no, because that's fascinating, because that kind of puts paid to my idea. I'd kind of almost thought of it as Venn diagrams. I don't know, I'm not good at maths, but for some reason I had sort of research as a subsection of a subset of rangahau. But the way you've described it means it's sort of, it's completely different. It's its own set, and rangahau is its own thing, and then you know, never the two meet, shall meet, whatever that is.
That's just my theory. If we really take the idea that the world is interconnected to its fullest extent, which is, I'm assuming, we're meant to do, because it crops up so often by people like Māori Marsden and Rose Petty, no less, then somehow we have to incorporate the workings of that at every point in our research.
Mm. Cool. Thank you. That's really helpful.
Good, Carl. Thank you. just opening the floor to people who've got any questions as well. Thanks, Becky, for that. That's been a question that we've all been asking ourselves, so it's now good to get another perspective on rangahau and research. Does anyone have any questions? Tarita? Kia ora, Tarita.
Tēnā koe, ōtira, tēnā tātou katoa, mihi ana ki a koe kāo, Ngāwi Whaiwā, ki te piritahi ki a tātou mātou katoa, I rungi tēnei hui topa.
Still can't hear you.
Oh.
I can. Oh, can you?
Yeah. Oh. Okay, yeah, can everybody hear me?
Kōpai.
Yes. Yeah.
Aye, so mihi ana ki a koe Carl, and I distracted him during his talk because I got a bit nostalgic. I see some things behind him that I used to sit beside and remember. But I was interested in something you said really on in the beginning. I didn't quite catch it. So my question is, what is kaupapa Māori in relation to that free food chain in terms of metaphysics that you talked about right early on? I didn't quite catch it.
Oh, so what I was saying was that I was working in the kaupapa Māori space, and that was very much about, it was almost sociological. If you put it in a discipline, it would be sociology. And so it didn't feel complete for me. Like, it wasn't taking into account the non-human enough. It wasn't putting the non-human forward enough in most of the aspects of it. But interestingly, if you look at kaupapa, it contains to it the word papa tuanuku, which is a heavily metaphysical concept as well as an entity. So I think the possibility is there for it to be renewed in that way if people wanted to.
Goodbye. Okay. I have a second question. If you believe, or we believe, and you've mentioned it a number of times, and Marston and you've mentioned Marston and somebody else about the world is interconnected, that thing that keeps coming up. If we are so interconnected, why then the need to design specific Māori philosophical measurements, if you like?
Well, I think that there's a lot of emphasis on things. So one of the discussions that's going on at the moment with another person who works in Māori philosophy and myself is the binary, which sort of feeds into what you're saying, Tarita. I think it's like we go to make sense of the world and we create distinctions between things, and we might give them Māori names or whatever. But actually, we have to resolve that. If the world is so interconnected, then we have to live by our statements somehow and send those distinctions we make back to the idea of oneness, maybe, which may end up destabilizing the, I forget the terminology used, but the specifics. And we should be prepared for that. So I'm not saying we shouldn't have ways of implementing things and coming up with terms for specific things, but I don't think that they represent, my own view is that they don't represent true reality. They're simply our ways of dealing with them. And they contain a vibrancy, but they are only vibrant because te katoa enables it to be that way.
So your true reality then has got to be based in some Māori space.
Yeah, but I think I don't think it's just a Māori space, maybe, you know?
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Kia ora, da.
Hi, kia ora.
Kia ora, Lidu.
Yeah.
Is our next question. Thank you, Tarita.
Tēnā koe, Carl. Yeah, I have a question. You mentioned that the philosophy is productive. Can you explain briefly, in what sense it is productive?
So it is productive, like anything is, I guess. I don't think philosophy is on its own there. It's just simply, it's generative, I think, but it's not, it's not final. It's never final. You can put forward a good argument about something, and you can put forward something which you think is, and that's fine, but that's it. And it doesn't matter how wedded you are to it. And this is something that we often have to get over with our egos. It doesn't matter how wedded you are to that argument and how good you think it is. It's only an argument. So I don't really know that the world is interconnected. I mean, one of the things that I remember, you know, one or two of the old people in my teens suggesting that. And that's one of the reasons that I find this also very interesting. But because it's cropped up so often, I'm assuming that there is some ounce of truth to it. So I want to pursue that. And to that extent, it's theoretically productive. But none of us really know. Like, none of us can see interconnection. The moment we think we see interconnection, there will be another stage behind there, another contingent behind there that we can't see. And so that's what is productive about it in that generative sense, is that you go from one idea to the next, and then to the next, and then to the next. And so, that's my idea of productiveness. But it's never, I mean, you could call it an outcome. I don't like those terms, but you could call it an outcome, but it's a very, very transient one.
Thank you. Thank you.
Do we have any other questions? We're coming just towards the end of the session. Maybe one question for Carl.
Oh, if anyone has questions or they want to follow up, you can just email me. But good luck with your everyone's work as well. That's the other thing I wanted to say. I mean, Māori philosophy doesn't have to exist in a vacuum. People can build on ideas as they're developing other forms of research as well. And that's one of the beauties about it. It's so broad. I mean, philosophy is considered to be the oldest discipline, and I can see why in the West that it's viewed that way, because it forms the foundation. So at any point in time, you're going to be thinking about your work, right? And it's at that point that philosophy can take form if you allow it to. Yeah.
I think what you've done for us, Carl, this afternoon is I think a lot of us are sort of still processing some of the one-liners that you've given and some of the ideas that have been presented, and the reality of our colonized reality, and the logic and what's not logic, you know, what's mātauranga Māori and the whakaaro, the language of philosophy. So there's lots there. In the chats there, it says, oh, maybe we'll bring you back to talk about the language of philosophy for 2024 series that we have. And we just wanted to say thank you. There's more questions to be asked. We've got a huge chat. This session is going to be recorded.